last lecture, we have observed the insulation and the refractory material. Today, I would like to brief you about the heat exchangers. So, what do you mean by heat exchanger? You can say, heat exchanger is a device which facilitates the transfer of heat between the two fluids is known as heat exchanger. And we have already studied the different type of heat exchangers in semester number 5 in heat transfer subject. So in this session, we are going to discuss the energy saving opportunities inside the heat exchanger, as well as I would like to recapitulate the classification of heat exchanger. So let me begin with the classification of heat exchanger here. Industrial heat exchangers are classified into number of variety. First one is according to construction. According to construction, heat exchanger is classified in 4 category, namely tubular heat exchanger, then after plate heat exchangers, then after extended surface heat exchanger and the regenerators. While according to the transfer process, heat exchanger is classified into 2 type, indirect contact type of heat exchanger and the direct contact type of heat exchangers. Then after, according to the surface compactness, it's classified in 2 category, namely compact heat exchangers and the non-compact heat exchangers. Okay. Then according to flow arrangement, it has a 3 type: parallel flow, counter flow and the cross flow. If the two fluids are flowing in the same direction, then but obvious we know that it's parallel flow. While in counter flow, both the fluids are flowing in opposite direction. Then after, according to the pass of arrangement, we have a single pass or multi-pass heat exchanger. Particularly saline tube heat exchanger may have single pass or you can say multi-pass. Then after, according to the process of heat transfer mechanism, particularly heat exchanger is classified in 2 type: condenser and the evaporator. And according to the phase, we have a 3 category: gas to gas heat exchanger, gas to liquid and liquid to liquid. Okay, so it is all about the classification of the industrial heat exchangers. Now I would like to brief you about different techniques by which we are able to save energy inside the heat exchangers. Okay, so let me begin with the topic called heat exchanger network analysis. So, what do you mean by heat exchanger network analysis? In order to understand this thing, I would like to take example of any process plant. For example, let's say we are dealing with the thermal power plant. So, we know that in thermal power plant, we have too many of pipe through which either hot medium is flowing or the cold medium is flowing. Okay, and secondary thing, because of the flowing of fluid with energy, particularly heat energy, there might be chances that we can save energy at certain point. For example, let's say in the thermal power plant, economizer is used to absorb the energy from the waste flue gases. Okay. Generally, in economizer, what is going to be happen, before supplying water to the boiler, it should require to pass through the economizer, and in economizer, the hot waste gas particularly gives its heat content to the feed water. Okay, so that we require to supply lesser amount of the heat energy inside the boiler in combustion chamber. Okay, so likewise we have a lots of possibilities there in any process plant, and in process plant we have lots of piping network through which the different type of fluid is flowing. So it's possible to exchange the heat between the hot fluid and cold fluid mutually, and because of the mutual heat exchange process, okay, we are able to conserve energy as well as we are able to reduce the wastage. So in heat exchanger network analysis, what we are going to do, we are going to arrange pipe in such a way so that the heat exchange occur mutually in between the hot stream and the cold stream. Okay, and hence we are able to conserve energy by reducing losses. So the arrangement of the piping structure of heat exchanger is nothing but you can say heat exchange networking, heat exchanger networking. Whenever we are deciding the arrangement of the piping, at that time we must observe the energy content of different pipe. The energy content of the fluid that is flowing through the pipe. Okay, clear to all? Okay, so here in slide you can read, we have a many streaming process plant, heating stream and the cooling stream. Okay, so it is all about the heat exchanger networking. In the slide you can read the different point, like for example in any process plant, as I told you, we have more than one stream, and through different stream different type of energy is flowing with the fluid. For example, fluid having the heat energy and fluid having the lesser amount of the heat energy, particularly cold fluid like refrigerant. So in heat exchanger analysis, what we are going to do, we are going to arrange the stream in a such a way that the mutual heat exchange is possible in between the hot stream and the cold stream, and this concept is known as the heat integration, or you can say heat exchanger networking. Clear? Now in order to understand, or you can say in order to arrange the heat exchanger network, we have lots of techniques available. But the one of the most common techniques that is found in 1978 and which is widely used is pinch analysis. Okay, so what do you mean by pinch analysis, and how pinch analysis is beneficial to us to conserve energy? Okay, to observe this thing, let's consider here we have one diagram. Okay, so just focus here on the diagram. So you can say here we have a hot stream H1, H2, H3 and cold stream C1, C2 and C3. Okay, for example, here just observe the movement of the cursor. The hot stream H1 is having a temperature of 200 degree, and I want to reduce the temperature of this stream to 100 degree. Then we have lots of options available with us. For example, we can arrange the flow of cold stream over the hot stream. So here we have a three cold stream with us, C1, C2 and C3. Okay, so C1, C2, C3 are passing over the pipe inside which the hot fluid H1 is flowing. So that because of the indirect contact through the pipe, there is a transfer of heat, and at the outlet, let's say here, after the C3 we have a fluid with a temperature, let's say 100 degree or you can say 150 degree. So at the outlet of C3 stream here, you can say, okay, we have a fluid having a temperature 150 degree. Okay, H1 is flowing at 200, and initially here I want to reduce it to 100. Okay, so I have arranged the three different cold stream over the H1, so that at the outlet of C3 here, near about C3, I mean to say, we have a fluid having a temperature 150, but still I want temperature drop of 50 degree. So to achieve the 50 degree drop, we should require one external utility, particularly cold utility. Okay, so that we are able to reduce 150 to 100 degree. Okay, so this one is we can say external cold utility. So likewise, we have lots of stream H2, H3. Okay, so we require to arrange all stream in such a way that the mutual heat exchange is possible in between the number of the stream, and we should require minimum amount of the external utility, let's say hot utility or the cold utility. So here just we have a thumb rule, like the minimum number of the heat exchanger required is equal to n-1, where n equal to number of stream, that is n1, plus number of utilities. Okay, so it is all about the heat exchanger networking, how we can arrange the network. To further simplify the problem and to understand further more, here I would like to discuss one example of pinch analysis. But before going toward the explanation, let me give you the some of the assumptions that we require to make while we are dealing with the pinch technique. So first assumption is that whenever you are arrange any piping network, at that time make sure that the first law and the second law of the thermodynamic is satisfied. Okay, then second is that the hot and the cold utility are of infinite heat capacity. means in example I told you that here we require to reduce temperature from 150 to 100 degree, for which I require one external utility. So the capacity of utility is such that we have required only one utility. Okay, so this one is the theoretical assumption that we need to make, but in actual practice this is not possible. But for the theoretical dealing we are assuming this thing. Okay, then next one is the steady state heat transfer operations. Okay, then after there is a no restriction of matching the different stream, we can arrange any stream anywhere. Okay, so that the mutual heat exchange is possible. Likewise, we need to make those type of assumption for the theoretical dealing. And one another assumption that you need to make, the all the heat transfer process is of indirect contact type and having the counterflow process, so that we will have maximum LMTD. Okay, so this type of assumption you need to make. Now let me focus on the example here. So in given example here, you can see we have one table in which this specific heat as well as temperature as well as stream numbers are given. Here we have two number of hot stream, two number of cold stream, stream number 1, 2, 3 and 4. The specific heat flow rate, that is Cp, is given for the all four stream. For one number it is 2, for two number it is 8, for three number it is 2.5 and for four number it is 3. While the temperature of all streams are given. Okay, so here stream number 1 is required to maintain temperature of 60 degree from 150. So we require to reduce the temperature of hot stream number 1 from 150 to 60. Similar for stream number 2, we require to reduce the temperature from 90 to 60. For stream number 3, we require increase of temperature from 20 to 125. A similar way for the stream number 4, 25 to 100 degree. And one another data that is quite important, that the temperature difference, minimum temperature difference of 20 degree is required. Okay, so what we need to do to arrange the heat exchanger? To arrange the heat exchanger, we need to identify the optimum temperature of all four streams that is prevailing throughout the heat exchanger process. Here you can see that in order to reduce the temperature of H1 from 150 to 60, and in order to increase temperature of cold stream, that is 3, from 20 to 25, we can arrange the hot stream and the cold stream using indirect contact type in such a way that the mutual heat exchange is possible between these two streams. But now what about remaining stream? Okay, so to arrange the complete heat exchanger network and to identify the optimum temperature that is prevailing inside the piping network, we need to plot the temperature profile. And from the temperature profile, we are able to obtain the pinch point range. Okay, so just remember all this temperature in your mind, okay, and start plotting of the temperature profile. Now, how to plot temperature profile? So let's focus here. Here you need to plot the temperature. Let's say for stream number 1, the digits are given. We want to reduce temperature of stream number 1 from 150 to 60. So plot 150 to 60 degree line like this. Just observe cursor movement. For stream number 2, we require to reduce temperature from 90 to 60. So here we have stream number 2. Now for stream number 3, that is cold stream, we require to increase temperature from 20 to 125. So plot this line like this. Okay. And similar way for the stream number 4. If you observe the diagram here, I mean to say temperature profile, you might notice one thing, that all the four stream is exchanging heat in between the zone in which the temperature profile is in between the 60 to 90. Okay. All the four stream exchanging heat mutually in between the temperature profile of 60 to 90 degree. So here you can say the temperature in between the 60 to 90 is our optimized temperature, which is maintaining in all the four different streams. So we require to arrange the heat exchanger structure, or you can say piping network, in such a way that the all the four stream is getting overlap, and due to this overlapping there is a mutual heat exchange, okay, in between the temperature range of 60 to 90. So it's our pinch point, so we are able to exchange the heat whenever the temperature is in between the 60 to 90 degree. So it is all about the pinch analysis, and this one is, you can say, it is our optimum zone of temperature at which we can exchange the heat between all the four streams mutually, such that we are able to minimize the loss. Okay, so it is all about the pinch technique and the pinch analysis, and here you can say our pinch zone is in between 260 to 90. So such kind of thing you need to explore, or you need to perform in order to identify the energy saving opportunity for the piping network inside the heat exchangers. Okay, clear to all? This one is just one of the small example in which I have considered only four stream, but in actual practice we can have a more number of stream, let's say 50 stream 60 stream. So for that you need to plot this type of the temperature profile, and for that generally the softwares are available, okay, like Siemens, okay, used for heat exchanger very widely. So it is all about the pinch analysis. Now I would like to start next topic, that is multiple effect evaporator and the condenser. So what do you mean by multiple effect evaporator and the condenser? To explain this thing, just focus here. You can see the multiple effect evaporator are the type of evaporator in which we are using the energy of vapor for the creation of our product, different product. For example, here you can visualize this diagram. Here we have three evaporators, first evaporator, second evaporator and the third evaporator. Okay, in all those evaporators water is supplied from the bottom here. Just observe the piping network from the bottom here. Okay, just observe structure. Now in first evaporator, in order to convert water into the steam, I have supplied here thermal energy, external thermal energy. So because of the heat exchange process, here we have obtained the steam, extremely superheated steam. Now this superheated steam is getting passed toward the second evaporator. Now this superheated steam acts as a source of energy or source of input for the second evaporator. Okay, and because of the heat exchange between the water and the superheated steam in the second evaporator, there is again generation of little bit superheated vapor in second evaporator. Now this little bit superheated vapor is again supplied to the third evaporator, where it behaves as a heat input for the third evaporator and transfer heat from the superheated vapor to the water, and again at the outlet of the third evaporator we have a heat energy in the form of the steam, which finally supplied to the condenser. Okay, or you can say we can use for the different purpose. Okay, and after the condensation we have here the condenser that we supply to the outlet. So in this structure you can see we are supplying the main heat energy, or you can say hybrid energy of heat. We can say hybrid energy only to the first evaporator, while in the rest two evaporator we are using the output that is generated from the second evaporator. So this kind of the treatments are quite useful for the thermal economy, and particularly this process are used in distillation plant, okay, where heat content requirement is variable across the different location. Okay, clear? So it is all about the multiple effect evaporator. Okay, and it is widely used in the milk industry as well for the generation of the different product like milk, then after cheese, okay, then after ice cream. So it has a very wide application in process industry. And in multiple condenser, similar kind of thing is happening, but instead of evaporator we have lots of condenser having a single evaporator. Okay, so it is all about the multiple effect evaporator. Now I would like to discuss the distillation plant. So here in this video you can see we have a crude oil that is supplied to the furnace. As it's supplied to the furnace, what is going to be happening? Because of the transfer of the heat, the crude oil will separate into the different part according to the partial pressure. Now this separated crude oil is supplied to the distillation column, where the crude oil which is separated into the different constitute is required to be heated. As it is heated, what is going to be happen, because of the boiling point temperature difference, there is a separation of product. Here you can see, as the crude oil flowing in upward direction, what is going to be happen, boiling point as well as the temperature of crude oil is going to be decreased. Each constituents will separate into the different product. Like here we have a petrol, kerosene, then after LPG, likewise. So that we obtain here product at a different temperature. Okay. So it is one of the process which is widely used to obtain petrol, diesel. Okay. Clear. So it is all about the today's session. Thank you.